So first, we're going to spend some time focusing in on, you know, plant manager, plant management in lean implementation, and then we'll also go into some questions that our attendees have submitted. We'll try to get through as many as possible. Might not be able to get through all of them, but we'll work our way through them as best we can. So let's start off with this. You know, what's been your experience in working with plant managers? If you can kind of tell us about that.
Well, it pretty much whenever I've been to a plant, I've either worked directly with the plant managers or with a lean champion, and always met the plant manager at the beginning of my visit, where I would get some input from the plant manager as to his expectations. And I met him at the end of the visit to report my findings orally to him, and then later in the form of a report. So those are people I've been in contact with almost on every case. I've never been a plant manager myself, but from working with them, I've developed a great deal of respect for them and for the role that they play, and particularly the public aspect of the role that they have and the pressure that it puts them under. They're truly the man in the arena.
Yeah, really kind of, I guess, the point of the spear of things that go on, certainly. So what would be the lean leadership role of a plant manager in, from your perspective?
Well, it varies in the course of a lean implementation, but initially you need to do an assessment of the plant, and the person who either does or commissions this assessment is the plant manager. And an assessment, I believe in doing a rapid assessment. It's a few days project. It's not a 3 months project. And the assessment should provide some idea of what the improvement potential is for this plant within a certain period of time, and identify, and that's the key part, identify projects that you can start right away. And the selection of those projects is not just based on technical opportunity, but on human opportunity as well. It's not enough that you identify a particular part of the plant where you can do something useful very quickly, but it also has to be run by somebody who wants to do it. So the human aspect is also part of this. So that's a key role in the beginning, and that's usually the plant manager doesn't do this himself, but it's done for him, and he takes responsibility for the choices that are made. Then he selects the pilot projects to be implemented right away, and that's without any prerequisites. I don't believe in providing a cascading weeks of training to the entire staff before starting anything. You really have to start right away with pilot projects, and it's a very small number of pilot projects, and with heavy support from the plant manager. So you have, for example, a production supervisor who is motivated to get the project done, and he gets direct support from the plant manager, and everybody in between just follows. And at this point, in the initial stages, I don't believe in having much more of an infrastructure beyond that. So the plant manager sets the conditions for these pilot projects to be successful, and make sure they get the resources that they need. Once they're successful, he arranges them to be publicized and for everybody else to know what they are and appreciate what has been done. And at this point, the people who've been involved in this pilot project seed a bunch of other new projects. And at this point, you begin to have more activity. So sometimes it makes sense to appoint a lean champion at that time who coordinates these different the activities of these different projects, bringing in consultants, arranging kickoff meetings and report out meetings and that sort of things. So you expand into multiple projects at this point. And if you don't pay any attention, if that is all you do, you get into a large number of small projects starting various parts of the plant without any kind of coherent vision. And that becomes a popcorn implementation. So to avoid that, at this point, the plant manager sets up a steering committee, which coordinates these different projects, prioritizes them, decides which ones should be done, which ones should be postponed, and makes sure that it moves in a coherent direction. So that becomes, at the end of year one, you have this kind of institution in place where project manager can come and explain the problems that they have and get that resolved. And that typically involves the plant manager and his direct reports, meeting on a periodic basis. And then when you go beyond that point, the organization and the structuring and the strategic direction of the implementation becomes the object of Hoshin planning. And then that's also something the plant manager is strongly involved in. So from the beginning to until about 2 to 3 years down the road, in a medium-sized plant, let's say 1,000 to 1,500 people, you get this kind of involvement from the plant manager. And that's not to mention all the duties that the plant manager has with reporting to the corporation what's going on inside the plant.
Right, to paraphrase it, well, the plant manager is kind of this funnel from the top, and from the top things coming down and out to the, I guess, operations as a whole, and even, I guess, the reverse coming up from the operations back up really is a sort of a linchpin, I guess, in the success of the lean transformation.
So sometimes management positions have definitions that aren't that sharp, but some of them have very sharp definitions. For example, the production supervisor, that's the first line manager, is in contact directly with the operators, and he's the only one who has this characteristic. The plant manager at the top of the organization inside the plant is in contact with the outside world. He's visible to the community, he's visible to the corporation, he speaks for the plant to the corporation, and to the plant for the corporation. And that's a very well defined role. That people in between may have some ambiguities, but the plant manager doesn't.
Okay. Well, you touched on some of these. So what would you say, how would you go about preparing to be a plant manager? I know you touched on some items, but we're looking at it from, okay, we're in the mode of how do we prepare someone for this position in this role?
Well, I think the plant managers who are very effective usually have rotated through a number of positions inside manufacturing. It can be done systematically, or it can be done because they arrange for this to happen. But the normal path to become a plant manager is to start as a production supervisor. So you finish, you get an engineering degree or a business degree, and you get hired as a production supervisor in the plant, and you work your way up through the production organization. But it also helps if in addition to this, you have a stint in production control or logistics, in maintenance, managing the maintenance operations, in the engineering group. And once you have rotated through a number of positions like this, you're essentially ready to take on the entire activity of a plant.
Okay. And go ahead.
One of the sayings that I think is maybe relevant to this is that culture is what remains once you've forgotten everything.
Sure. So
by the time you're plant manager, the engineering skills you had 10 years ago are obsolete. Right?
Yeah.
But so you've forgotten all of that. But having had that, having been in the shoes of the people who are currently in that position, enables you to have a constructive discussion with them and understand what their concerns are. Yeah, so that's what it brings to you. Not that you have the technical ability to do all of the jobs of the people who report to you. Hopefully you don't. Hopefully they're better at it than you are. But you're able to have a discussion with them, an informed discussion, and understand their concerns.
Yeah, I guess, yeah. So perpetual learning, but also so you have the ability to have these relevant conversations with people to understand and help them and so forth.
Yes.
Okay. Well, what would you list maybe three things, maybe three top things that plant managers should do to implement lean?
Well, I'm going to mention things that aren't necessarily immediately obvious. But the first one I would say to study TPS, study the Toyota Production System, and study Lean. Read a lot of books about it. Get informed about it, because many people tend to underestimate what it takes. So that would be point one. The second one is in all the implementations that are not as successful as they should be. One key point that is common is that engineering issues tend to get short shrift. And so the second recommendation would be among the things the plant manager should do is to not give, not underestimate the engineering issues of lean implementation. The interfaces between people and machines and that sort of things. And the third one, when you have a company with multiple plants, the different plants tend to have a not invented here attitude towards ideas from other plants. And it's really part of the plant manager's job to make sure that this doesn't happen. That if a sister plant has a great idea, an innovative way of doing something, then this is given due consideration in his own plant, his or her own plant.
Any specific things they should do to help facilitate that or prevent that?
Well, yes, facilitate the communication between people, between the engineering level communication between people in the different plants so that they don't feel that foreign one another. And bring it up, mention it, because it's not something that people will readily admit to doing, but it's something that they actually do.
Yeah, I know. I've experienced that very thing myself multiple times. It could be quite coercive if not dealt with properly. Well, what are there any specific, you mentioned about reading or studying, are there any specific topics you think you might would recommend for them to take a look at when you mentioned about reading or studying some things on lean from at least the plant manager perspective?
I've recommended some introductory books that they don't need to know all the techniques to the detail level in which, for example, in lean logistics, there are several chapters about how to implement all the different kinds of Kanbans, and that's more detailed than a plant manager needs to know. On the other hand, there is one of the books that I've recommended for a long time is Kiyoshi Suzaki's introductory red book. I forget the title, but he's written two, and this is the first one. And it's an older book. It's from the
1980s. That's a classic.
But it's a classic. It's very good, very well written, very clear, and very accurate as well. So I would definitely recommend that one.
Okay, good. Well, kind of counter to the things that maybe three things a plant manager should do, what might be three things that a plant manager should never do in going through an implementation?
And, well, the first thing that I'm thinking about on these areas is implement tools by rote. So corporations say you should do things this way. Okay, so we just roll it out because we have to. Well, sometimes if he has to, he has to. It's maybe a condition of remaining employed, but it's not a good thing. It's not going to be conducive to success. If at all possible, don't implement tools by rote. That was one issue. The other one is, and it's very difficult for people who have a strong technical background, who are now in a management position to do this, but don't inject your own ideas in technical discussions with your groups. Because the minute you do, they're never going to be given the same consideration as the ideas of other people.
Sure.
So I found out from Google that they have a name for this. It's called the HIPPO. It's the highest paid person's opinion. and they have an explicit recommendation not to pay particular attention to the HIPPOs. But it's the people who are in that position, the best way they can make sure that that doesn't happen is to refrain from expressing themselves. So they let their subordinates come up with the technical recommendations, and maybe offline they can discuss them. But in a meeting, if they start injecting their own technical ideas, then they take it over and the discussion is ended. And the third point is that I think they shouldn't be doing is don't be a suit. That is, it's something I looked in some of these other questions. If you're a plant manager and you walk around the shop floor in a suit and tie, it creates a barrier, and it has much more impact than you can imagine. It's an enormous difference when you see the plant manager walking through the shop floor dressed like the people who work there. And so don't be a suit, dress like the people who work for you, and that facilitates their interactions with you.
Okay, that's good. No, one thing, kind of a question, maybe narrow in on something, is you said certainly don't implement tools or so forth by rote. I know one of the things that's often said is implementation per need. Can you give any insight on how to, maybe on what plant managers should do or people should do to, discover or move towards those needs?
Well, there are, when you identify pilot projects, these pilot projects generally should be depth first transformation of a small part of the plant. And when you do that, it's not going to be just one tool. If you convert a particular segment of a process to a cell, you're going to touch on how you deliver parts to this cell. You're going to touch on visible management. You're going to touch on how you design operator jobs, how people rotate between different positions inside the cell as part of their job within the takt time. You're going to touch on all of these, on all of these. And if you're going to do that in a plant that does machining of aerospace parts, it's going to look very different from what the way it looks in a plant that assembles cookware.
Sure.
And so you could take the recommendations how to do a cookware assembly cell and bring it to a machine shop, and it would be completely irrelevant.
Yeah.
So you really, that's what happens when you implement tools by road. You take a blueprint on how to do something from another context, and it's not applicable to your context. So if you do, you're not going to get the benefits that you expect.
No, that's an excellent
point. Alternatives to understanding what you're doing.
So good. Well, let me go to some other questions, maybe some more general questions. This one's you've touched on some of these things, but maybe kind of narrow in a little bit. But what would be some of the obviously, I think, as you mentioned, one of the roles of the plant manager in particular is to work with people, communicate with them, and so forth. Are there some lean techniques that you would recommend to use as far as them empowering their staff or encouraging them to contribute to the ideas or improvements and so forth?
Well, I think the behavior of contributing to contributing ideas is something that comes naturally to people, to humans, right? And yeah. So if they, it's not really natural for them not to do it. So the reason they don't do it is because there are barriers that are in the way of doing it. As I mentioned, some of the barriers to doing this is visible signs of rank. Because we're in one category, you're in another category, and you stay in your place, we stay in ours, and that discourages the kind of exchange that is really key to people contributing ideas. The other one is again, when somebody in the management position starts injecting his own technical ideas at a lower level, that also prevents it. So this is very important to encourage people to contribute the ideas. They have to think that they're smarter than the boss, and they probably are. It's probably true. But they have to think that way. The boss must not assert. And it's very dangerous for the boss to do this. I've seen cases where the high level manager came up with something that was completely wrong, based on a technical error on his part, and nobody picked up on it for another 6 weeks before an engineer who didn't know any better pointed it out. Okay, so it's really dangerous to do that. The one thing is, how do you get started? And even in an organization that doesn't have a culture of improvement in place, you find people who can't help themselves. They will express their idea. They'll say, why don't we do it this way? Regardless, because that's the way they are, and they don't have the inhibitions that a lot of other people have. And the key thing is how you treat these people. Particularly when you decide not to use their ideas, you want to make sure that they feel rewarded for having presented them, and that everybody around them sees how they're being treated, and that it's not dangerous, and that you can actually improve your situation by doing it. So that's another aspect: how you treat uh, how you treat people who do volunteer this kind of information, even though the environment has not been conducive to it in the past. And finally, you need to organize to do this. It's not just informally encouraging people to contribute. You have to have structures with which to do it. So there are a number of structures that are in place in a number of companies, and you typically should have several. Very small things that just do it. So you have a talk with your production supervisor, and you implement something very small without even mentioning to anybody. That's a simple thing. Then you have the scope of things that are done through individual suggestions. Then you have the scope of things that are done through small group activities, circle type of activities. Then you have things that are done through Kaizen events or similar activities. And then you have things that require extensive projects that may take several months and involve a number of people. You have a range of type of activity, which all need to be in place as a structure for you to provide a structure for team members to actually contribute. So you have to combine all of this to get to a situation where they actually do.
Sure. Okay. With that, so in these types of roles, how would you recommend to deal with people that are lean skeptics?
Well, the one thing is when you get started, and again, the percentages may vary, but you're going to have a minority of people who are willing to work with you and who are enthusiastic about getting involved and leading the transformation of the plan. You're going to have a majority of fence sitters who say, oh, no, we've had an improvement initiative every 6 months for the past 30 years in this plan, so this too will pass. People feel that way. And then you're going to have people who are dead set against it. So, and you can argue until you're blue in the face and give speeches and send people to training seminars. That's not going to move the needles on these people. So the strategy to get out of this situation is to identify the people who are eager, willing and eager to help, work with them. And that's why when you select the pilot project, you have to have these people in charge of pilot projects. You have to know who they are. And even if there's a better technical opportunity elsewhere, in terms of a project, the project will work out better if it's in their area of control. To identify not only just a good technical opportunity, but a good human opportunity to get something to happen. And you do that without drawing unneeded attention in the early stages. It's almost stealthily. You work with the project team without drawing, and it's going to make mistakes, and you don't want to have hundreds of people looking over your shoulder while you're making mistakes. But they'll be successful. Once they're successful, you publicize what they've done. And the fence sitters get off the fence, say, oh, I'd like to do that as well in my area. And then the troops that you have, the army that you have to lead the transformation of the plant grows this way. And the antagonists, initially, you may be able to co-opt them, but you may not too. And some people eventually leave if they don't want to get on board. But it's the actions that you take and the projects that you implement and the successes that you achieve that gradually win over the rest of the group.
Okay, good. Another question. This is actually a number of questions certainly touch on this, and this is a very common question. But how do you engage in executives, or what would you recommend to engage executives to not only just support, but really act upon the transformation of a lean enterprise?
Well, the one thing you're talking about engaging people who are above the level of the plant manager.
Yeah, because that's a question. I mean, in all the years we've been doing our summits, that is absolutely the most common question. How do we get our executives, how do we get our leadership engaged? And that's usually meaning, a more executive level type folks.
Well, the bottom line, it usually doesn't work, right? And the way you have to do it is that you have, if you really want to do it, you have to get yourself in that position, and then you can do it. If you're really in an organization that is led by people who don't want to do it above you, you have very limited options. I only know of one case where one engineer, I have a lot of respect for, I met him about 20 years ago when he signed up for a class I was giving through UC Berkeley Extension. We've been friends since. And he went back to his plant. It was in, an aerospace plant in Seattle, and he just went ahead and implemented things. And his management saw the results he was getting, and they came on board, and it became a much larger project. So he's the exception. Usually, the initiative for lean transformation comes from top management. So if you're not in top management and you want to do this, you got to get into top management. In your company, if you have the opportunity, in another company, if you don't. But if you're a plant manager in a company that has 30 different plants and the top management is not on board, I don't know a way forward in order to and I wouldn't recommend to a plant manager to take the initiative on his own because it's very dangerous. The result might not be what he or she would want. So unfortunately. The only answer I can give to that question is get yourself in that position, and then you can do it.
Yeah, that's really, I don't know how many conversations I've had over the years is tell people, never forget this stuff once you end up in that position. Don't become that person that you're complaining about when you get there, certainly.
There's certainly a danger of that, yes.
Okay. Well, good. Well, actually, we're about to our time, and I knew the time would go by fast. It's always great. You know, it's great to have this conversation with you and get your insight, and we very much appreciate you sharing this, Michel. And I, like I said, very much looking forward to having you at the Seminar on Lean Leadership next month. And thank you for your time and sharing your insights and experience. And with that, I will turn it back over to Jacqueline.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Is it just okay?
Sorry, back on. Yep. All right. Well, Jim and Michel, thank you so much for facilitating our session today. Michel will actually be speaking at the Summit on Lean Leadership held in Charlotte, North Carolina on June 21st through the 22nd. So to learn more, please visit www.thesummitonleanleadership.com. Also, we are offering a special discount for everyone who is tuning in today. So to receive the discount off of the summit price, please type in the discount code WEBINAR for $500 off the price. Again, that's WEBINAR for $500 off the summit price, which is also listed on the slide you're seeing in the background. So to wrap up, I wanted to remind everyone that today's webinar is being recorded. So look for an email following our time together for a link to the recording. And feel free to share this throughout your organization. So thank you again, Jim and Michel. And thanks to each of you for participating in today's session. Goodbye.